Hi. Isn't it great to be able to make a cuppa and settle down in our comfy chairs for church at home? Welcome, and thanks for joining us today. I hope that you're making yourself a cuppa and feeling at home in your place. Whether you're on your own, or whether you have your family around you, or whether you've invited somebody over to enjoy church at home with you. You know, we've been thinking about John chapter 15 for a few weeks now, and verse 10 is one of my favourite verses in that chapter. In the Message translation, it says, "Make yourselves at home in my love." That's what Jesus invites us to do today. As we sit down to worship him and to see our friends on TV and just hear what God has for us, Jesus is saying, make yourselves at home in my love. In this time of isolation and uncertainty, that's a wonderful promise, not just for when we're doing church at home, but for every moment of every day. As we make ourselves at home in Jesus, he is able to surround us with his love, with his comfort, with his encouragement. You know, in verse 7 and 8 of that same chapter, he expands on that a bit more, and Jesus says, "If you make yourselves at home with me, and my words are at home in you, you can be sure that whatever you ask will be listened to and acted upon." Wow. Let's make ourselves at home in him. Let his words sink into us today so that we can make our prayers knowing that he's listening and acting on them. God bless you.
Thank you. Creator, you made humankind in your image and blessed us with your love. In these troubling times, as we live with the daily reality of physical distance, hold us close together in spirit. Remind us, Jesus, that when we abide in you, we are capable of great courage and compassion for others. In these times of challenge, we give thanks for those who are striving to make a difference. Government leaders, civil servants, emergency services, personal, health workers, scientists, journalists, and caregivers. We give thanks for all who put common good above their private concerns. We give thanks for the generosity of those who donate their time, talents, and money towards serving the needs of others in this community, this nation, and our world. Spirit of life, we know that in these troubling times, feelings of impatience and frustration are normal. When these feelings arise, give us the grace to take a deep breath and center ourselves in the present moment and in your loving presence. In times like these, feelings of loneliness or helplessness are normal. When they happen, let us remember to reach out to ask for a listening ear or to offer one, to listen for a kind word or to speak one. Spirit of life, hold us together by the strength of your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
God just spoke to me one night and said, right, let's record sessions, let's make activity bags so that we're still going out to these families every week. They're getting a session, they're getting an activity to do. So yes, I came in and recorded all the monthly music sessions of the term. I then, over many weeks, made up all the different activities for the families to do with their kids when they're at home. I've done a number of drives around to drop them off to the families. I've also been doing normal phone calls and texts. I've also arranged Zoom phone calls where, you know, I've arranged for the kids to get out their favourite toys and things so that we can get on the phone and they can see me, I can see them, we can talk about what they're having fun doing. And it's also given me that opportunity to speak to the parents about how they're travelling through this difficult time for parents who are suddenly stuck at home with little kids with no out. It has been a challenging time, so it's been really great to just be able to talk to them and offer them whatever support they might need. I think just providing that support and contact for the parents and the children. Particularly, I had a number of parents who had newborn babies. We've had four babies born in first term. So suddenly these mums were stuck at home with newborn babies plus toddlers, which can be a really challenging time. For me, it was making sure that they were supported, but it was also following up. You know, one of my families lost their full income, another one lost partial income, and just providing emotional support, but also offering as a Salvation Army what other services are available to support them at this time. Being in the same space as the families, and you know, for the kids, it's sitting down playing with them, or you know, just coming alongside a parent, putting your arm around them or a hand on their shoulder and saying, I'm here for you. It's that physical contact. When I was doing all the dropping off of all the activity bags one day, I breached social distancing because, you know, I got there just as a parent found out that there was uncle was terminal and she was very emotional. And just being able to give her a hug at that time was, it's one of the things that we really miss when we're in isolation. So, yeah. How to record sessions. I got here thinking, yep, this will be easy. Got the laptop out, thought we'll do this. Didn't have the program set up to do that. So then thankfully I had my husband and son here and we've set up the phone, rubber banded it to the tripod so that that would all work. And also how to do Zoom phone calls, having never done that sort of thing before. It was really the technological side of it. Yep, big learning curve. I think just being more intentional with talking to families about, you know, I'm praying for you. Because although we do discuss that at mainly music and playgroup, it's, been much more of a conversation. I think it's been really special. And just getting more connected and knowing more about these families, because you're having, each week I've got this chance to speak to all the parents, whereas now I'm each week making contact with each family. And so you're getting more conversation. Yeah, so that's just something that I'd like to continue after we get back together. It's just really opened doors. Yeah, just that there is more opportunities out there. There's more ways that I can be keeping in contact with these families, and whether that's going into the future, you know, I find some of the parents find it hard to get together for a cuppa, but whether I do Zoom calls, all those sorts of things, just to further engage with the families and to be more intentional about talking about God. They're so open to hearing it if we're willing to share it. Well, I'm in general just praying for our conversations with our families and our weekly sessions. But I would love if there was a couple of people or a few people that would love to come on board as prayer partners to cover those families in prayer each week. That added prayer support would be fantastic.
Good morning, church. Today I will be reading from John chapter 15, verse 9 through 17. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in with you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I have learned from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other. Amen.
Good morning. Over the past fortnight, we've been considering the Salvation Army's national theme, Pray It Forward, which is 21 days of intentional prayer and prophetic listening, praying for our national movement and our own local context here at South Barwon. We've been encouraged to use the scripture found in John 15, 1-17 as the overriding text. This passage is entitled Jesus Teaching About the Vine and the Branches. Essentially, during this time, we're asking the question, how is God calling us to serve? In the first week, entitled Deeply Connected, the question was posed, how do you stay connected with Jesus? People have shared ideas like prayer, listening to music, strolling in nature, writing, getting creative by drawing or painting, getting alone in solitude. There's no right way or wrong way. It is finding ways to draw closer to Jesus and connecting with the life-giving power of the Holy Spirit to empower your life. During this COVID-19 pandemic, we've had the opportunity to slow down, take stock, and think about the things that are important in life. Karen even challenged us by asking the question, have we taken full advantage of this time, or have other things taken our attention? I can't stress enough that our true purpose as an individual and in community as a church has to have its foundation in Jesus Christ. Did you know that there are about 18 inches or 45 centimetres between your head and your heart, and some people will miss heaven by those 18 inches or 45 centimetres? They know God in their heads, but not in their hearts. They intellectually believe the gospel, but they never let it change their hearts. The most important truth that I ever learned is I was made by God and for God. This truth means that life for me makes sense. Now, you might know string theory, chaos theory, or quantum physics, but if you don't know God, you've missed the purpose of your life. At the end of your life, God will give you a final test. Here's the good news. It'll be an open book exam, and all the answers are in the Bible. On that test, God won't ask you if you got straight A's. He won't care how well you did in your career. He won't ask you to see your personal assets and liabilities. Instead, he'll ask you this. Did you get to know me? Did you build a relationship with my son whom I sent to earth to die on a cross for you? If God asked you today, do you know my son? How would you answer? You see, a personal relationship with Jesus is the essence of our Christian faith. The Christian life is a supernatural life flowing from Jesus to us. It can only be experienced as we live in intimate fellowship, abiding or remaining with our Lord. The analogy of the vine and the branches highlights this. A branch draws its vital juices from the vine to which it is united. In the same way, we draw the spiritual vitality that enables us to produce fruit from Jesus. Therefore, Jesus says clearly, apart from me, you can do nothing. Jesus demonstrated this by keeping close to his Father and being responsive to God's will. In the same way, we keep close to Jesus by being responsive to Christ's will, by obeying our Lord. Jesus never abandons us. Any failure to have intimate union with Jesus is our choice. The wood of the grapevine is stringing and twisted. It can't be cut into timber. It can't be shaped into furniture or utensils. It is valued only when it lives in the vine bearing fruit. So Jesus' picture of the branch thrown away and burned is intended to emphasise uselessness of that branch that is not producing fruit. Note that Jesus did not say the believer is thrown away and burned. He said the believer who fails to produce fruit is like a discarded branch. You and I have been chosen by God and called in a relationship with Christ that we might produce the fruit of true goodness and display God's character in our world. If we fail to have an intimate relationship with Jesus, the penalty is an empty and useless life, not abandonment by the Lord. Yes, God calls us to live in intimate union with his Son, Jesus, but that calling is an expression of his great love, his desire that we might know fulfillment and joy. How is your relationship with Jesus going today?
One day, a girl named Brittany made some biscuits for her friend Joel. She knew that Joel wasn't feeling very happy at the moment and needed something to cheer him up. She knew that sharing with her friends would make her happy, and that was going to be the best thing ever. Joel was so happy when Brittany gave him the biscuits. He told her that it meant a lot to him that she'd thought of him. After Joel had enjoyed his biscuit, he thought, "This is so much more than I need for just me. I know that my friend Philippa would like some biscuits. I'll give the rest to her." So he took the last one to her. When Joel gave Philippa the biscuits, she was so surprised and happy. She told him, "Thank you, I really needed this today." But after she had enjoyed a biscuit, she had the same thought as Joel. "This is so much more than I need. I'm going to share it with my friend, Marshall." Now Philippa took the biscuits to Marshall, and of course he was so happy too. But guess what? He had the same idea as Brittany, Joel, and Philippa. He knew that he didn't need this all for himself, and he knew that his friend Brittany loves biscuits, so he took the last one to her. When Marshall brought the biscuit to Brittany, she was so surprised, a biscuit from the batch she had given away. When she had been generous and shared with others, she was rewarded more than she could have ever wanted.
Wasn't that a great story? You know, in John 15:12, it says that God shows us love and he wants us to show love to others. But not just normal love, generous love. More love than we could ever imagine, just like God loves us. You know, Brittany showed this generous love to Joel. She showed him more love than he could know with cookies. And we all know cookies mean love. So, next time we want to show love to someone else, God's love, we need to show it generously. If that's through action or prayer, remember to show love generously, more than you could ever know. Bye guys.
During this past week, we've considered this idea of letting go, cutting back. Karen challenged us to use these 21 days to imagine what God wants to do in our own lives and in the life of our church here at South Barwon. Earlier this morning, we heard scripture from John 15, 9-17. Have you ever considered that word friend? I believe that it is one of the most significant words in scripture to help us understand the Christian life. The significance is seen in Jesus' analogy in this passage. A lord or master has the right to give his servants or slaves orders. It is none of their business why the master gives us command. Slaves are responsible only to obey, and they must obey or else. While Jesus is Lord and therefore has the right to give commands which must be obeyed, he has chosen to call his followers, you and me, friends. This means first that he shares his purposes and motives with us when telling us his will. And it means second that we are given a choice not available to slaves. A friend may respond to a friend out of affection, but a friend does not have to obey. I remember as a kid when I was learning to play a brass instrument. All too often my parents would hear, "I hate the cornet." Pouting and miserable, I'd head off to practice, but only because I was told I had to. I never really enjoyed it. I much prefer to be outside with my mates, kicking the footy or playing cricket. My good mate, who was an accomplished musician, loved to practice. He seemed to be always involved in some band or orchestra, or was heading off to some music camp. As I reflect on this, I'm struck by the difference between having to practice and wanting to practice. I'm also aware that my friend was and is gifted in this area, whereas God didn't wind me up this way. It's just this difference that Jesus implied, and that is the key to a successful Christian life. God doesn't want Christians to go out pouting and miserable to obey Jesus because we have to. God wants Christians to be Jesus' friends, to eagerly respond to his wishes and commands because we want to please him, not out of duty, but love. We show that we are Jesus' friends when we do what he commands. For God will not force us. Instead, Jesus invites us to respond to him out of love. It is out of love that Jesus wants to prune and cut out practices in our life that become a hindrance to growth. Karen and I want to encourage you each to spend time listening to God. Spend time reflecting in his scriptures, because we believe that God wants all of us to be part of a decision-making process. We believe God wants us each to come on this journey and become more intentional about what we do and why we do it. Two questions that we ask you to consider is, what is Jesus saying to me? And what am I going to actually do about it? As we consider these questions, we see the purposes that Jesus has for our lives and the opportunity to have so much more. As Jesus' friend, he has chosen to commission us to produce lasting fruit in our own lives and in our community. You see, it wasn't nails that held Jesus to the cross, but his love for you and me. And it is this love that he encourages you and me to share with our world. So ask again, what is Jesus saying to you? And what are you actually going to do about it? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for the opportunity that has been ours to come together in worship, to sing praise, to learn about you. And Lord, right now I want to thank you for this 21 days of intentional prayer and prophetic listening. Father, I pray that you would reveal things in our lives and in the lives of us corporately that may need to change, that we would allow you as the true gardener to come in and prune the grapevine, to take care of the branches, to remove things that may be not of you. Father, I commit each of us, and I commit our church at South Barwon, that we want to be followers of you. Father, direct our paths, lead us in your way, and Father, give us the boldness and the courage to follow where you lead. Father, I pray for everyone that you would enable us to look deeply in our lives and we would want to take advantage of the so much more that you have on offer. Speak to us, challenge us, make us strong, make us aware of your presence, and may we just draw closer to you. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. All glory and honour to your Son. We worship you. Amen.
Thank you. Hello there. We're just here, we've just watched the benediction ourselves, so I thought it was right time to give one myself. I just want to give a quick encouragement to everyone stuck at home from 1 Thessalonians. We want to say, rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And enjoy a cup of tea, time with the family, or give a friend a call.
Thanks, Jack.